everyone. Well, I'm really excited to be here. Thank you so much for being so warm and welcoming. When I came to the first city camp, I was a minority. I was the only Carrie person sitting in the room. But there's a lot more of us. If you don't mind, I would like to see how many of you are from various places. So raise your hand, and it's how you identify. Right? Where you live. So how many of you identify to be from Raleigh? How many of you identify? I need to clap. How many of you from Cary? From Morrisville? Chapel Hill? Carborough?
I thought this was the same.
Garner, you wait for us. We have a Charlotte contingent, I understand.
They're still sleeping.
They're stuck in traffic. How many of you identify as not one of the above?
Durham.
Durham.
He's Wake County, right?
Yeah. The t-shirt that you have.
You mean the Durham-Raleigh t-shirt. Airport?
Yeah, the Raleigh-Durham Airport. I'm really glad to be here. This is really close to my passion. And my goal now is to bring up some CIOs who we're really glad to have here along with their moderator. Let me tell you a little bit about their moderator, John Stevens. I think he's uniquely positioned to do this today because not only is he from the UNC School of Government since 1996, but he wrote the book on dispute resolution and conflict management. So if any of the CIOs get into break into a fight, we now know that guy who can fix that. And mediation, right, John? Mediation. He's more importantly, though, he's active in the Code for Durham, and he's been researching civic technology for quite a long time. So please welcome the CIOs. I'm just going to call you the four CIOs, as well as John, who will introduce the CIOs.
I'll dub this panel the Four Amigos CIO version, and my job is to do very brief introductions. We'll do some opening questions that I'll place, and they'll take turns sharing their experiences, where they think civic tech is going, and their roles in it, and reserve about 15 minutes for your questions and comments from the audience. I guess Jason, you or someone else is going to be mic runner at that point. Not Blade Runner, but mic runner. Okay, so working from your left to right, on my immediate left is, Darnell Smith, CIO for the City of Raleigh since January. And before that, extended a career in the private sector, including the Elster Group here in Raleigh. Where he was managing a global staff of 110 IT professionals. Darnell has a bachelor's in computer science degree from NCANT, again, fellow public university, and an MBA from UNC Wilmington. Okay, and then immediately next to Darnell is Bill Greaves, CIO for Wake County since 2012. That wasn't enough for Bill. In 2015, he added another CIO, Chief Innovation Officer for Wake County. And while Bill says, yeah, I do a lot of things professionally, what I really want this audience to know is that I write fiction under the alias Griever Williams. Look him up. Speaking of innovation and aliases. Moving next to Bill, Jay Nichols. CIO for the City of Greensboro, thanks for making the I-40 drive, and for the last 2.5 years. Broad array in her portfolio, including working with the fiber optic network, connecting all the pieces of the traffic and facilities in the city. couple of Jane's other roles. She's on the advisory board for the UNC Greensboro Bryan School of Information Systems and Supply Chain Management Department, and co-lead for broadband access with the National Research Network, and many other things. And a very nice addition beyond our government CIOs is a university CIO. So please welcome Leah Krause, who is the CIO at North Carolina Central University in Durham, where I live, go Durham. and before that, had a very interesting path there. Her first CIO position was with Guilford College, small school in Greensboro, and then became Associate Vice Chancellor for Services and Planning at UNC Wilmington, so we have a UNCW connection here, and then moved on to her present position at North Carolina Central University. In 2015, Leah was identified as one of the best CIOs by Triangle Business Journal, and she was recently featured in Sync, SYNC magazine, for her transition from classroom teacher to CIO. So a very good panel here, and I'm gonna just move forward with our first question, ask Darnell to reply, and then move on now. So the first question is, how have you approached open data, and how have you worked with outreach within your large organizations, but also with partners outside of your government or university units?
That is a long question.
I'm a professor.
But within the city of Raleigh, we have a very good open data team. And in that respect, they have been reaching out within the departments. We have some things going on with strategic planning and also trying to build in business metrics. So what I want to say is our city manager is really big on being data driven, okay? And as a part of being data driven, IT is a big part of that. So what we have done is identified data sets that we believe citizens will use, and in doing so, made that available on the web. So now, what was the second part of that?
Any particular focus on partners outside the city for this kind of open data work?
Wow. So as far as partnerships, we have gone the grant route. And so we have some things going on with smart city initiatives. We have Knight Foundation, where we're working on making data more accessible, more searchable. And we also signed an agreement. We just signed it as it was Wednesday of this week with NC State. We're an MOU where we'll be working with them on smart city initiatives. They have a lot of intelligent people over there. We have a lot of needs within the city. So we feel like it'll be a partnership that'll help us move the needle.
Great, thanks for mentioning that last piece. For those folks who were here last night, we heard a good piece of that new partnership on the smart cities.
So at Wake County, we have a similar leadership style to what Darnell experiences in Raleigh, in that our county manager and the whole, really a lot of the organization, is very interested in data-driven initiatives. So we've had a portal for a few years now, but I got to give a shout out to Bill Scanlon. He's out there somewhere. He's our open data coordinator. You might have heard him last night if you were here. He has built a very strong governance group within our organization that has really, I think, not only helped drive the structure of the data and the value of the data, but also the willingness and openness to share data sets. So he has done a great job in building that out internally. And then we also have a lot of very valuable external partnerships. We have federated data portals with the city of Raleigh and with the town of Cary, where we share lots of data sets because, again, the citizens don't know who manages what data, so we try to make that as seamless as possible, and that has worked really well for us. And then we have a lot of other technology partnerships with NC State, with UNC, where we use their skills and our skills and try to combine them to get something that's even better.
So at the city of Greensboro, we are really just starting into our open data program. And we started down this road about a year ago, and we started moving towards an open data portal. We put some data out there just in a beta test mode, and we held our first hackathon with Code for Greensboro, which was awesome. I was still learning about all of this, and I went to the hackathon, and over the weekend, I was amazed at the number of apps that were created over, I think we had like 4 or 5 data sets out there, and I said, wow, this is really something exciting that we want to move forward with. Well, shortly after that, we were accepted into Bloomberg Philanthropies' What Works Cities program. And so part of that project or acceptance into that program gave us access to resources from Sunlight Foundation and John Hopkins University's GovX to assist us with developing our open data program and also performance measurement. So we've just, since a year ago, and working with What Works Cities, we've developed our open data policy, we've developed governance, we've put together our data coordinators, we've started talking with departments, and one of the big hurdles actually was educating our staff internally, educating department heads and the leaders in the organization as to why we want to do this. They're like, you know, why? It just sounds like a lot more work. But educating them, and they're starting to come around now. It has taken us about a year, but they're starting to come around now and get on board and actually to see the benefits, not only externally what this can do, but internally. Departments are finding out, oh, I didn't know you had that data, and I've been doing this manual report, and now I can use your data to say these kinds of things are starting to happen when the light bulb is coming on, and they're going, oh, okay, I get it. I see what this is. So that's where we are. It's been an interesting year, and we're excited about the program.
So I guess I'm the, which one of these is not like the others person on the stage?
You're all amigos.
So in the university and in the university system and part of higher education, as you can imagine, we produce our consumers of, and you all want a lot of the information for any student that you have coming to us. So I'll talk about student success, and then I'll talk about research. And I'll probably do that with each of the questions that are asked, just so you kind of get a sense of us as producers of data, similar to my colleagues, but also as consumers of data for the researchers. So as producers, what we have in each university is our fact book, and that, of course, is already public and open and is massaged. And then we have various entities that want lots and lots and lots of data. The most interesting thing that the UNC system has done recently is something called the Student Data Mart. And it is available and open on the UNC system website. And that kind of brings together a lot of the student information, graduation rates, retention rates, and everything. And so as a system, we're already looking at student data and how we can use that student data to ensure success, graduation, and retention rates. At NCCU, one of the things that we've done is partner with various vendors in having them help us understand from an analytics perspective what our data does so we can better use things like financial aid and scholarships. So that's been a huge piece. Our research component, if you didn't know, NCCU does a tremendous amount of research for underrepresented, underserved populations in the health fields. So we generate, and are consumers of, as well as generating, lots and lots of data that other people want. So that's two of the areas that we've partnered with other universities, as well as medical facilities and other researchers, as well as producing data that you all care about.
Great, thanks for, hold on to your mic. We'll just come back the other way on question number 2. So behind door number 2 is, how do you see the challenges in working with open data? And do you have any tips for folks out here for addressing those challenges? And I know in our planning call, Leah, we talked a little bit about that in terms of certain laws and for everyone, the issues of open versus privacy and those kinds of things that are on many folks' minds.
Especially for students, right? There is some information as aggregated is fine, but we don't let you look at each individual student. But I was pondering that question. And so on our campus, my favorite phrase and our favorite challenge is, what is the definition of a student, right? So we have early college students on our campus that take courses, but they're not paid students, so we don't get funds from them for the state, right? So they're still a student on our books, they're a headcount, but they're not a paid FTE. So part of the challenge with any data, and Jane mentioned this a lot, is how are we using it? What does it mean? Do we have a common understanding of the definition of any one piece of data? That, for higher education, is of great concern. If you're looking at graduation or retention rates, and I'll compare myself, NCCU to UNC Chapel Hill, what we do with our graduation and retention rates with the students that we attract and allow accessibility for our students is a different population, right? They come to us a little different than the students at UNC Chapel Hill. So when you're looking at apples and oranges, or Tar Heels and Eagles, you're looking at things, you have to understand the context of that data. So I really encourage that for me as an opportunity, as a challenge, that would be something where, you know, help people not just see the percents, not just see the statistics, but get underneath that. Data means nothing because all of us can interpret it however we want to, right? It's that common understanding, that common language that allows us to utilize the data to make decisions, to do things better for our students, for our health environment, for whatever those things are. So from my perspective, that's both a challenge and your opportunity.
So I already mentioned one of our challenges, which right now has been educating our internal staff and the leaders in our organization about open data. And so now the challenge we face is getting this program up and running and getting things off the ground, getting data sets up there. And everybody, you probably know, many of you work in government, so we're all trying to do more with less, and people are already, you know, doing all they can do with what they've got. So finding time to implement this program and to do it the right way. But luckily, fortunately, we have people like Jason Marshall who have really taken ownership of this and helping us get it off the ground. And people who are coming in who are committed to this, who want to see this happen. So getting the resources that are going to help with inventorying the data, determining which data sets should go up, because we want to prioritize those data sets. We want to make sure that the data sets we're putting up there are quality data sets and valuable data sets, that we can start seeing some of these interesting apps and services and things that can be created based on that data. So the challenge of selecting the correct data. One of the conversations that we have internally about how to do this is we don't want to just regurgitate everything we have. I mean, certainly we eventually want to get to the point where we're putting everything up there that is public record, but we want to make sure that initially we look for things of value. So that's one of the challenges some of the challenges we're facing right now, just getting the program up and off the ground.
Okay. my answer is very similar to what Jane had to say. I would go a little bit further for us and say that what we try to focus on internally is that, I believe it was Carter, I think she's here in our GIS group, she might have taught me the word curate. We curate the data so that we're not just putting out everything we've got, we're putting it out in a valuable level of content so that it's usable. But then the thing that I think we really want to push to do, and we're constantly going to have to do, is to make sure that we're putting out the data sets that are of value to the community. So the right ones, but also putting it out in a format so that it's not too technical to eliminate some of the people who might be able to do something with it. So this is a very technical audience, and we want to remain in connection with you all in events like this. And we have several people on staff, Bill, Chris, Carter, and others who are very committed to this type of development process. But I want to be able to try to stretch that also beyond the technical community so that we could maybe take advantage of some of those other opportunities out there as well. And I think that's a constant process for us, a constant refinement. So we're open to suggestions and feedback, both on what kind of data do you want to see and how do you want us to put it out. And within reason, we'll do our best to try to accommodate that so that we can all get the value out of it going forward.
So I'm going to stick with the same theme. And if we go back 2013, I think we had about 14, 15 data sets. And if we fast forward to today, we're over 350 data sets. So that's an extreme amount of data that we put out there. And I think our biggest challenge is ensuring that we have accurate and clean data that we're putting out there. And so now if you look behind the stage, and what you'll find out is all of our systems aren't connected, and we don't have a single source of data. So one of the biggest pressures for us is, how do we ensure that we're pulling the right data at the right time to feed the machine of what we're providing you as far as open data? And I think the second part is, even internally, as we put this data out there, we have internally discussions we need to have with our departments, because who owns that data? And how does that data, how does it make me look? And is it going to present what we need it to present as far as to the city? So there are conversations we need to have to make people comfortable with us putting that data out.
Very good. So this is my last question for the panel. We'll go with Darnell and down the row. So please get ready for your questions or comments. So this one is future-oriented. So please look forward, say 2 to 5 years. How do you see open data, open source opportunities and innovations, and how do you see your organization moving forward into the change of the open data and multi-connection ecosystem? So Darnell and then on down. Yeah, I know.
I knew I chose the wrong seat. But the biggest thing for me, if I fast forward, I think we are at a period now where data is king. There are a lot of studies going on around how we should be more data driven, number one. Our organization in particular, we're putting in the right policies and procedures as we speak around data management. And if you fast forward, we're in this, I'll call it the growth curve. And when you fast forward, I think in 3 to 5 years, we will have that core data out there that citizens need to help us make decisions. So where I want to be is, when we have a decision to make within the city, sort of like we did with the UDO rezoning, that we have the right data out there so that people can understand what we're about to do, give us input so that then we can make efficient decisions. And then as we make those decisions, we know that we basically have the community behind us. So I think the technology is there. It's just us getting the people and processes behind those technologies to be able to do it.
Data emergency coming in from the street apparently.
And to add to what Darnell has to say, I would like to see us in a place where we're doing a better job of leveraging the talents and the passion of people like you in this room to make our organization better. Because no matter how many resources we have, it's never going to be enough to get everything done. So it's a constant state of prioritizing and fighting the fires. Literally, like the fire truck, but also the ones that are, you know, in the forefront. And so we're never going to be able to match the talent and the passion. I use that word a lot at work, but I really want to try to connect our organization with the passion of the community, and then those people who are willing to apply their talents to help us get things right. And it's a very difficult job sometimes to get it all done. We rarely do get it all done, I would say. But I would love for us to find the methods and the tools and the resources to do more of that and to build more of that connectivity, make that connectivity stronger, and make the stuff that you guys are able to produce be beneficial to the community as a whole. And I would love to see us continue down that path. I think we're all on the right path and being a part of this type of organization, but I want to see more and more of that going forward.
I think this is a very exciting time. I think we're seeing a convergence of data and gigabit speeds over the internet. Do any of you remember dial-up? Anybody around that? So, back in before dial-up, yes. So back in the days of dial-up, we could not have even imagined having a smartphone, being able to stream video to a smartphone, being able to video conference around the world. The things that we're doing over the internet today at 10 to 20 megabits per second, what a change. Now think, when we go from 10 to 20 megabits per second to gigabit speeds, what's that world going to be like? we can't even imagine. I would say we can't even imagine what that's going to be like. The way we're going to use data, the things that we're going to be doing, when we all have gigabit internets and are connected by gigabit speeds, our lives are going to change. Our lives are going to change because of this. And you all are sitting right on the verge of all this. So I think this is just such an exciting time. So that's what I see. I see the future being fiber, I see the future being gigabit, and the future is data.
So the couple of things I'll add to that is I think integration of data, and we kind of talked a little bit about that, is really critical to the success of this. Especially if, again, I'll go back to higher education, wouldn't it be nice to have a place where you could see U.S. News World Report, the Princeton Review, iPads data, all of that, so as parents, if you are, or siblings, making decisions about where you might want to go to school or where your students might want to go to school, again, from a higher ed perspective, then our researchers on our campus would benefit greatly, even more, from this kind of open data. The kind of open data specifically around solving medical problems, I think, is critical. A lot of times, while higher ed is very open, there's a lot of IP around higher ed, and especially around research. And I think the more that we can encourage that to be open, in addition to what we have going on from the government perspective, the better off we are at solving those problems. So for me, it's back to integration. And then I want to also reiterate about data governance. I think that's really critical component, data governance, privacy perspectives, and all of that.
Okay, I think we're pretty much on time and ready for your questions or comments. Aha, I see a hand over there.
Not everyone wants.
Jason will do this running. Please get ready. And first question, please.
Hi. So, Darnell, I wanted to ask you, does the City of Raleigh have a standing meeting to discuss who owns data and how it makes you look? Or are those one-off discussions? So basically, I'm wondering, how important is it that internal structure is solid for the success of using open data outside of government and then to our communities?
Okay, that's a trick question. Up until this point, I think our data sets have been more situation-based as far as, so if we want to do something with, let's say, the UDOB zoning, I'm going to use that one again, then it is pulling the right people together to understand, at that time, what the data set would look like, who owns that data, and how do we keep it fresh. We do not currently have, across the board, a data governance group. And that's one of the things we're working to put in, because now we are at the point where we have so much data that we can't sustain it in one-off fashion. Did I get it?
Yep, that's perfect. Thanks.
Anyone else want to add to that before we go to the next question?
Same. Question, we do have a standing governance group that's coordinated by Bill Scanlon and Carter, and it primarily consists of the major data stakeholders, the ones that own the majority of the data sets, and they meet on a very regular basis to discuss general policy around open data, which data sets should be added, you know, curated, any details related to our governance process.
Okay. We see next question over on the far right, Jason. I hope he has his fit going today.
Hi, I work in state government IT, and I'm not CIO, but I know there's data everywhere. I'd like to be open. What's my one-line sales pitch to convince people? And Darnell touched on this a little bit. Like, I want data to make me look good. What's my tweet link sales pitch to convince someone who's reluctant to make their data open?
Go ahead, Leah. We'll jump in on worth 140 characters
that.
Right now.
Transparency helps.
And I'll jump on this in a very different way. Again, we can't ignore the shooting and death in Charlotte this week and the protests and violence, some violence around that. And what's at least driving that story apart? What is going to be transparent and what's not. And I'm not going to take a position on this, but I think that's where the real heavy rub is when you get to video, public spaces, and identifiable people. In one way, we want all those videos going to try to catch the bombers in the New York area, for instance. but it's going to catch all of us. And what happens with that when I go and hug someone who's not my wife, but is my cousin? And but who gets that and uses it in whatever way? Anything else besides transparency helps and don't hug your cousin?
Things you hear at City Camp.
Find a champion. Find a champion who is passionate about this, who wants to spread the word in your organization at the state and to get to the right people. Call on your Code for Raleigh Brigade to come in and maybe do some presentations or show some of the apps that have been created off of open data. Just talk about it. And when you get it up to the right person who gets this, they will move it forward. And that's what we've seen in Greensboro.
The thing I would add is maybe don't think of it so much as a sales pitch, but identify some of the data sets that are already out there and they're hidden because of a convoluted website or they're just not popular because nobody can understand what they are, and maybe sort of approach it as, I'm not adding something new, I'm just redesigning the way we put it out, and then get a couple of those small wins. That's what we had to do with the county, get a couple of those small wins. Then you start approaching people, well, you know, if we got this data set out there, and then find some examples in some other state governments of people that have done something similar and they're a little bit ahead, so you've got some case study there, and presumably ones that could show some benefit to the government itself.
Oh, I got one more thing. If you get a lot of public records requests, like we do, and you can say, hey, we can put this stuff on an open data portal, and people can go there instead of you having to spend your time to look this stuff up and give it to them, that wins people over pretty quickly, too.
I'm going to close. So my pitch would be, when you look at where we're going with data, this is a data-driven society. So why don't you help us shape how we put that data out there versus being in a position where we're forced to have it out there at a later date? I want to be ahead of the curve. I want you to be ahead of the curve with me. So let's work together to make sure that we're representing the city and our data in the right way. That's my pitch.
Okay, thank you. Excellent array of views from our panelists. What's our next question? I'm sorry, we're going to wait, Lori. You're going to MC the rest of the morning, so we're going to come back to you at the end.
I'm the lull.
The
helping with the lull.
No, there's no lull. Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, just a general question about maintainability. So I'm a user and abuser of data, and so frequently when I find something interesting, it's a one-shot. It's a one data collect sort of deal, and there's so much more that can be inferred from, okay, if I have this data again 2 years later, you can draw a lot more information from that rather than it just being a one-shot deal. Is there any sort of plan in place or anything that you guys are doing to, you know, once you publish data, to say, okay, how do we update this? How do we provide new data since we've put this out here? Is there any sort of plan, or is it more of a one-shot deal? Okay, we've got this data set. We want to use it because zoning is important right now. Is there anything that's going to lead to, okay, we need to update this in some sort of time frame now that it's out there?
I'm going to jump right on that. So that is one of the important pieces. The more data we put out there, the more input we need from you folks. We have limited resources. So when you give us feedback about what's important to you and the use of the data, and you can help us build the business case, then we know where to focus our resources. So a lot of times, Adam Martin's in the back, I believe, but he's
always in the background.
He is terrific around making sure that we're putting our data out there in a timely fashion. But it's a struggle sometimes when you have as many data sets as we do. Is the data really being used as we think it's being used? And we really need that input from you guys so that we can focus in the right areas. So I don't know if we have avenues for that, but I would be very open to figure out how do we get that input from you, because that only helps us provide you with a better product.
So as we're developing our program, that's part of what we're doing. As each data set we identify that's going to go on the portal, how will it be updated? In some cases, there'll be automated feeds that will just keep the data up to date. In cases where data is more static, there may be a process where it gets updated yearly. But part of our governance and our policy around open data and the way that we're building the program with the help of Bloomberg Philanthropies is to put those processes in place so that ensures that the data stays up to date.
The word I would use, go back to that word I used earlier, is that we do try to curate the data that we have up there. And so that means taking down, we track the use of the data, and if it's not being used, then we'll tend to take it down so it doesn't get cluttered, and try to keep the automatic feeds going for those data sets where it's possible, and the others to try to get the new data up there as soon as possible. If there's something specific that somebody's looking for that you wish you had, then definitely talk to me about, well, not me. Talk to Bill and Carter back there. They do the real work about getting something specific up there on a more regular basis. We do our best to try to meet those needs because that means somebody's actually using it for something beneficial, and we want to do what we can to support that.
The consumer use of longitudinal data in higher ed is very well known. So if you wanted to see what schools were doing from year to year, again, that student data mart has begun to do that. It might be an interesting way for some of our colleagues up here to see how it can be done. We call it census data, the 10th day count, which I could go into, but nobody really cares. And so I think that from that perspective is what's happened over time is a really interesting approach to data to, you know, yes, it's being updated yearly, but maybe I want to see what's happened from year to year. And so the student data market is happening at UNC General Administration as well as what each school does on their own might be an interesting way of looking at that.
Okay, got a couple minutes for one or two more questions.
2 minutes left. Okay. Do we want to do closing remarks?
No. We're not. Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. I overruled.
Live, folks. Live.
So we did all of this discussion about open data, right? There's another aspect of this, and it's about our youth as well. And it is getting people interested in technology. So I just wanted to make a mention to our Digital Connectors program. Right, because there's another side where we need people that are, number one, interested in technology, then number two, want to be civic advocates, and they are going to be the future folks that are going to look at this data, try and figure out how it applies. They understand how they can help the community, so it basically closes the circle. So I just wanted to close with that to make sure that we keep programs like that going and keep people interested in technology.
Okay.
Do you want to maybe summarize takeaways for you,
Jason? No, I'd rather take, see if there's one last question. Aha, okay, you're going to do your running, Jason. Wait, you're right there.
We've got to stay on time, man. Got one thing.
So with all the open data, big data situations, how are you balancing security with your data?
Well, I can't answer that one. I stole the chief information security officer from Darnell before he left Elster, so I'm in good hands, and if she screws up, I'm going to blame him. We've been talking about open data. We haven't really been talking about big data because there's a very big difference for us. But security in general is paramount to us because of the dependence our organization has on technology. And so we actually, in the county, we have a 5-person security office, including a chief information security officer, who they have their hands in everything that we do new, everything that could potentially be exposed. They understand the risks, and we qualify those risks as to, is the risk worth the potential reward in everything we do, the basic security practices. But security is probably one of the least sexy and most dangerous topics that we all have to deal with in our roles. And I don't want to talk about security. That's no fun. This is supposed to be fun. No, but it is definitely a balancing act. And one, I'd say security comes first over open data. Once it's secure, then we're ready to open it.
And we in Greensboro have a cybersecurity team. We have monthly meetings with that team, which is part of IT, but with network folks, with the applications people, with the database administrators, and we're constantly reviewing our best practices and our security. Now for the open data portal, that's cloud-based, so it actually does not touch our network, so once the data is up there, it's accessible, but it's not connected to our network, so there's a separation there.
Okay, we'll let Darnell and then see if Leah. Okay, Darnell, we'll have the last word and we'll wrap up. Go ahead.
I thought that was a very good question because while we talk about open data, the city also has personal information on all of its citizens. And that's one of the reasons, I can't remember who mentioned it, but we have to have the right processes in place to ensure that that data doesn't get intermingled with our open data. So security is a big part of that, and that's why sometimes when you want data, we have to go a little bit slower to provide it to you to make sure we have all of the checks and balances and processes in place so that that doesn't happen.
Okay, I'm sorry, Lee, it does have a last one.
I just want to say that that is one common thread that is across all of us. We're all having to have the same conversations at our institutions, locations, government about data. Security is paramount, is number one, and is something that I don't know is the one thing that may keep me up at night, that budget.
Okay, so let's please thank our four amigos, the CIOs. We will step off the stage and Lori Bush will come back up for the next section.
Okay.